We would be honored if you would join us.
So here we have a breakdown of what the 2-4-2 can look like across the field. On the left side, you have your A channel. In the middle, you have B. And on the right, you have C. And for right now, in this situation, we're just going to be attacking the top of the board. But on the left, you've got A. Center, you have B. On the far side, you have C. If you notice, if you look at the forwards and how the forwards break down in a 2-4-2, there's two forwards on one edge. There's four forwards in the middle, and then there's another two forwards on the far edge as well. And so the general concept is that those forwards, those players, want to do their best to stay in those zones. The 2-4-2, we want to spread teams out as much as possible. So now we've included the backs and see how they play out. In the A channel, you've got 11 and 13. In the C channel, you've got your 12 and your 14. And in the B channel, you have your 15. In parentheses, you've got your 9 and your 10. That's because those two players can essentially roam wherever they would like. The 10 really controls the direction and the pace and the flow of the game, where the 9 is typically going to follow that ruck and follow that ball. If you notice on the edges you've got, obviously you have two forwards, and then you also have a wing, and then you have a center. And so it's balanced on either edge. The 15 is your secondary decision maker. It doesn't have to be the 15. It can be whoever is the secondary decision maker in on your squad. We're going to call this role, that 15, we're going to call that role, that's the joker. So for this video, we're going to call this player the joker. So looking at this example, from the edge here, we've just attacked in the A channel, and this is our current ruck that we're in, okay? This is one look that we want to give, and what I want you to specifically look at is what the B forwards are looking to do. There's two groups of prongs, two forwards here, and another two forwards there in blue, right? This is an example of how we want to look if we want to attack off of 9 coming back. So say 1 and 3, they're the first prong, okay? If 1 is going to take this ball off of 9, okay, that is a tight ball. We don't want to stretch the D here. We want to clump them, okay? And so that is a tight ball from 9 to 1. 3 in support, all right, he is not a meter away. He's not 2 meters away. He is essentially latched on to number 1, okay? Because as soon as 1 takes it in, 3 is going to be there to ruck over. So we want him on his hip, essentially holding his shirt, helping him over the gain line and into contact. You notice here, we have 4 people in this ruck. Say hypothetically, 11 took it in. That means we have number 8, 6, and 13 rucking over. We are gonna do what's called a skater. Essentially what a skater is he is just gonna skate from ruck to ruck. Very simple, he's just gonna go from one ruck and he's gonna go straight into the other ruck. If you are the last person in this far channel, if you're the last person in this ruck, so say 8 is the first one over, and then 6, and then 13, right? If 13 is the last person in this ruck, he is gonna be the skater. What's really important here is that 9 is helping communicate to who that person is, whether that's by name or by number. Typically by name, that's probably best in the chaos of rugby, but letting 13 know that he is going to skate over and he's going to help support this ruck that's right here. The distance of this ball from 9 to 1, we want that to be short so that it's easier for number 13 to come over and for him to support with his skate. So here we have just hit the forward ball off of 9. 1 has taken it in. 3 has rucked over while latched on into contact, driven through contact. 13 has skated over. Those remaining 3 players have reloaded into a small attacking line on the weak side if we want to come back. And on the strong side, We still have our other prong. We've got our 4, 5, and our joker, the 15, ready to attack either directly or spread it wide on the outside shoulder of the 10. We are about one-third of the way through the field, right? And so we're split, and we can really attack anywhere we want almost on the field here. At this instant, within this moment right here, this is where we are most dangerous. Because we can either come back and we can continue to condense the defense, or we can spread them wide very, very quickly. So this is our setup. This is where we want to be. And now let's talk about what the rest of the phases can look like. So here in this example, we've just hit the forward pod off of 10, and we've sent them up, either with a tip pass or something like that. As you can see, we've got the two forwards, the 4-5, and the 15, the joker. You're all in this ruck. You're always in this ruck. The 10 here just continues, and now the 10's got four players, quality players on the outside of him. And so they just form an attacking line. For right now, we're just going to be able to run through the hands. We don't need any set moves or anything like that. We just want to keep it simple, and let's be accurate. Let's just run through the hands, try and spread them wide. If a 7 or if a player sees a hole that they're able to exploit and attack, whether that's on a crash line or something like that, 7 wants to take a short off of 12 or something like that, we could definitely do that. There's less of an emphasis on spreading the ball all the way to the, you know, to the 5-meter line here, because 1 and 3, as you can see on this side, these guys from this ruck back here, they are now working around the corner, and they are preparing for the next ball off of 9. So once we make it all the way out to C, we still need to be able to come back, right? And so this off-ball work is extremely important. 1 and 3 coming around the corner, they are anticipating that this ball is going out this way, and so now they are setting up for this ball off of 9 to come back. So we've continued with our attack, we've gone out wide, we've hit this group here, we've got our 2, 14, 12, and 7 all in this far ruck. See how 1 and 3 have made it across, and now they're ready for another ball off of 9. You've got the 10 floating in behind. This pod here, this group, the 4, 5, and the 15 are the joker. They've all reloaded back to the middle of the field here, as well as these players here, they've all reloaded. If we go ahead in this example, let's go ahead and talk about what happens once we attack weak side. So say we hit 1 and 3 right off of 9. We have our 7 skate. These players here have come back. They formed an attacking line again right off of 9. A consistent reason why we'll go back to the weak side, despite there just being, you know, obvious defensive, we have an overlap, is if we don't get good go forward. If we don't cross the gain line, we'll go ahead and we'll attack that weak side just to go ahead and we want to reset with that. So say hypothetically we don't get across the gain line, we want to go ahead, we attack that weak side again. So now we've attacked back to the comeback, and now we have 1, 3, and 7. They've all reloaded. If you notice 7, he does not go back with his original group. What would the point of that be? Why would he do that if all he's going to do is come back and ruck with this group again? So he's going to stay with this group. They're going to form a 3-man pod, all right? And now you've got a tip pass on either side you can carry off of 9. Again, a great reason to do that, or a consistent reason that we will be coming back to the weak side, is if we don't get good go forward off of the initial ball off of 9. But we can work these two back and forth as many times as we want, as many times as we see fit. 7 will only reset and go back to his original group, 2, 12, and 14. He will do that as soon as the ball makes its way out and hits this pod. Once it hits this pod, we are going strong side. Once it hits this pod, we are going strong side. And so that means that 1 and 3 can begin to make their journey around and start preparing to take their next ball off of 9 that will be over here. So we've played back and forth here several times, and now we have decided that we want to attack wide. The 10, in conjunction with this pod here, can attack in 2 different ways. Let's talk about those ways now. For simplicity's sake, we've removed all other players and all other numbers. All that we have and what we want to focus on here is we've got our ruck and our 9, our 10, and now we've got our pod off of 10. We've got our joker, and we've got our 2 forwards here. Okay, we've got our plus call if we want to tip on the outside. We have a minus if we want to tip on the inside. And we have our bump call. Our bump simply is 5 is going to run through, 15 is going to hold his line, and then he's going to come around the corner here. This ball is going to go from 9 to 10, 10 to the point man here, and as 5 runs through, the joker or the 15 comes around the corner. He's going to hit him on a small, a very, very small little pass as he comes around the corner, and now we're attacking wide with this far group out here. So that's our bump call, and that's one way that we want to attack using a triangle shape. The second way that we want to attack using this pod here off of 10 is what we are going to call pinch. Pinch is, this is when or if the 10 sees something and he wants to have a go. Say that they are shooting up out of the defense, is shooting up here and they're really attacking this group, right? This is just a different look that we can have, and it allows the 10 to have a go at the line. So the 10's going to get the ball and he is attacking this space here. That's his space and he wants to attack it. Meanwhile, we've got 5 coming up and we've got 4 coming up as well. So now we are pinching the defense here, because if these defenders, if they shoot and they come up here, right, and they're attacking the pod, now the 10 has a hole and he can have a go. He's got a green light, he can have a go here. And now he's got, and say hypothetically the 10 does get tackled, right? Now he's got 2 guys, 1 and 2, who are gonna be there to ruck him, right? The other option is that the 10 can still hit 4 or 5 on a little bit of a flatter pass, and they're just hit and they'll take it in. If 4 or 5, if they take it in on pinch, the 10 is in this ruck, right? The 10 is in this ruck if he does that, because he's going to be closest, all right? Now, the other option is if you notice 15, the joker here, right? He's going to hold his depth a little bit. He's making a very, very small, very, very subtle line out the back and around the corner, right? So as 4 and 5 attack this line nice and flat, 10 now has the option to take it himself. He can hit one of these guys on a flat ball, right? And they're going to take it up, and he can help ruck for them. Or he can use these guys as dummies, and he can hit 15 out the back, and now we are attacking wide. And that is our pitch. 1 and 3 will not always be able to make it from their ruck here to the far side, okay? So we do need to be prepared for that. So say hypothetically 1 and 3, that prong just get caught up in their ruck. A really, really frequent thing that's gonna happen, and we do need to be ready for this, is if we call bump, right, or we go out the back on a pinch, right? So say we go here, here, and the ball comes here, and we hit 15 as he comes around the corner for a bump, right? And now we're attacking wide. These guys, they cannot be expected to make it from here to the far side of the field. That cannot be an expectation of them, okay? So what does need to happen is that if we go from here to there, what we wanna see is we wanna see 4 and 5, well then they need to assume the role of this forward ball off of 9, and then 1 and 3, they reset, and now they become the prong off of 10. Rather than them working all the way from side to side, we just do a simple reset, and 4 and 5, now they become the forward group off of 9, rather than 1 and 3, and 1 and 3 now become the forward group off of 10 with the Joker. Now, it's not realistic for us to expect that these two forwards will be able to make it all the way to this far corner every single time, right? They get gassed, they get caught up in rucks. That's a reality of rugby, and so being able to adapt is really important here, okay? All we want to see off of that is, if this happens, say 1 and 3, they can't get there. Instead of waiting an extra 3, 4, or 5 seconds in this ruck, we want quick ball. We want to move that ball. We want 2 to 3 second rucks. And so all we do is first phase when we come back is we just go straight off of 10. And look, we keep it very simple. We're direct. We're very, very direct if it's first phase. We're always direct if it's first phase. And all we do is we go 9 to 10, 10 to this group, and we hit up. And now we've got an attack here. There's no skater when it's off of 10, right? There's no skater when it's off of 10 because they have the Joker. The Joker is always on the outside shoulder of the 10 with the first group. He's always in the first group here, right? Once these guys go up and they attack here, all four of these players, all of them reset into a small attacking group, to a small attacking line here. And now let's talk about what we're going to do with this group here. We just hit the pod off of 10, and now these four players, there's no skater when it's off of 10. So these four players all reset, they all reload into an attacking line here. And all we do with this center, right, the center from this far group, or the playmaker from this far group, right, all he does is he just fills into this role. And now we're off of 10 again, right? So now we've got another pod here, and all we did is we had this 13. All he did is he just slid from here to here. And he knows that this is coming. As soon as we're in this far ruck, and as soon as we hit a pod off of 10, off of the first phase when we come this way, he knows that this is coming, and he knows that he needs to fill into this role, right? At the very least, he knows that he is going to have to help support this ruck, right? So here, we're right back into the same calls we have. We can hit a plus, we can hit a minus, we can hit a bump, we can hit a pinch, right? We can do a lot of things. Off of this second phase, probably most frequently will be called a pinch, just so that it's easiest and the 10 can really suck in and take out these central defenders in this area with this prong right here attacking straight up, right? And so if, hypothetically, these guys take it in, so say we just hit the group and we hit a minus and we're through, right? We still have an entire group of 3 out here to attack again as well. So we are always have, if we do this, we always have at the very least 2 ruckers to support us at all times when we take the ball in. So say hypothetically we take this in here, 4 takes it up, this is what it'll look like. So now we've hit our second group, or our second pod off of 10. And now we just want to go same way, and we are just spreading this team out like crazy, right? Teams are going to have a really hard time covering that amount of space, especially when they're used to protecting against like a weak side attack continuously, hitting a ball off 9, then hitting the comeback, hitting the ball off 9, hitting the comeback, or at the very least having to protect against the ball off of 9 the first time. And so this is just a really quick, very, very simple variation. And this is often going to have to do with, probably in higher level, it's really going to have to do with what the 10 or what the second decision maker is going to be seeing on the field, what the defense is giving them. But it's also going to have to do with how much gas these guys have in them, the 4, 5, the 1 and the 2, the B, the central forwards, how much gas in the tank they have. If they're huffing and they're puffing, go ahead and throw a variation at the defense. Call the ball off of 10 first phase, and let's just spread it out, and let's allow these guys to just catch a breather, and then we can reset once we make our way over here. Something that's really important is if you notice on all of these lines, we've got back, forward, back, forward. All that does is it helps spread out the security of the rucks in these attacking lines. On my teams, everyone always has to be able to ruck, whether that's 9, 10, wingers, everybody has to be able to ruck. But this just helps and allows us to spread out the security of those rucks, no matter where or who takes these in the field, takes these into contact, we're always going to have at least one very, very surefire ruck supporter there. So once we make it out here, these guys, if you notice these guys from this previous ruck, these two over here, they're jogging, right? They're taking their time and they're making their way across the field to get ready and get set for once these guys take it up, we want to be able to hit a ball off of nine right here and we're back right where we started.
Hey, you're very good. See you next time.